So I want to speak to you today about the good life. Now, this is Labor Day weekend, and there are a lot of people who are working hard in their life to go after this, whatever that might mean to them. Have you ever met anyone who has all they need and then some? They work hard, they make money, but they still demonstrate from their life a lot of discontent and lack of peace. Have you known it? Do you know anyone like that? When we think of the good life in America, what comes to mind? We have a television medium that's very powerful, movies that are very powerful. We have images bombarding our senses, images that would try to make us believe that the good life is the life of indulgence. It's, you know, the picture of the guy, you know, with the champagne in his glass, surrounded by a couple of women in a jacuzzi, having money to throw away. You'll know exactly what I'm saying. Or it's the picture of all the friendly faces laughing and having a good time at the bar. It's funny, you know, when I grew up, I knew people, relatives that would hang out at the bar, and it was never like that. Never. But the images that we get try to tell us this is what you have to do in order to have the good life. There's a man in the Bible who made it his obsession to go after the good life. Have you ever heard the expression, if money was no object? Well, for this guy, money was no object. He had all the money he could use. He had power. He had influence. And he made up his mind that he was going to experience everything that life could dish out. Because he was going to experience the good life. But you know, there were two major challenges that he faced. Two. Uncertainty and certainty. Those were the two elephants in his living room. While he's going after the good life, he's considering these two elephants. The first elephant is the uncertainty of the future. Because life changes. You're sitting here today, you're listening to a sermon. You might not know, you don't know what you'll be doing next Sunday at this time. You may be in circumstances that are fabulous. You may be in circumstances that are extremely difficult. Or you may be just sort of like you are today. But you see, the future is uncertain. And that really messes up a lot of people. Because we want to control everything, but we can't. We might be, our nation might be a nation at war within a month from now. Everything changes about the economy. We don't know. But uncertainty challenges us, and certainty challenges us. It challenged this man, because he wrote about it a lot. And you know what the certainty is? That we all die. I mean, you can store it up, you can have, you know, the best stuff, the most stuff, and everything to go along with it, and you still die. In fact, the statistics tell us one out of one dies. Now you say, well, that's kind of depressing. No, no, no. Follow me. It doesn't have to be. You can have a good life even with the two elephants in the living room. the uncertainty of the future and the certainty of death. Now we're going to look at what this man wrote. His name was Solomon. And he wrote a book that's called the Book of Ecclesiastes. And in this book, he's describing his struggle with trying to find a good life, the good life. And much of the book is written on the perspective of under the sun. That's a very key phrase in the Book of Ecclesiastes, because he's writing about someone who's searching for answers that's in the world. It's sort of like saying, you ever hear the expression, humanly speaking? Well, a lot of Ecclesiastes has been written kind of humanly speaking, as one who's struggling to find himself. But then he also is able, by the Holy Spirit of God, to look above the things that are under the sun to find that meaning in life. Let's see what he says here. Ecclesiastes chapter 9. This is what America says. I want to be happy. If you ask people about the good life, what are they going to say? Well, I just want to be happy, or I want to have it. This is what Solomon said in the book of Ecclesiastes about the good life. Go, eat your food with gladness, and drink your wine with a joyful heart, for God has already approved what you do. Always be clothed in white, and always anoint your head with oil. Enjoy life with your wife, whom you love, all the days of this meaningless life that God has given you under the sun. All your meaningless days. For this is your lot in life, and in your toilsome labor under the sun. Whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all your might. For in the realm of the dead, where you are going, there is neither working, nor planning, nor knowledge, nor wisdom. Can you say amen?
Amen.
At the reading of the word,
amen. Amen.
And so, enjoy. Enjoy a good life. Do you think that God takes pleasure if we're miserable in life? Do you think that He wants us to be miserable? Now, please don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying, well, every day is going to be a rah-rah. You know, you're always going to feel this on top of the mountain. You're never going to have struggles if you follow Jesus. I'm not saying that. But I am saying that we have victory over a miserable life. We don't have to be defeated in this life. So, if we're going to enjoy life, what does Solomon teach us? What are some of the secrets that he shares? Now, these are secrets, but they're not so secret. They're right in the Bible. But people think they can find happiness without the Bible, without God. Well, good luck. But Solomon shares with us secrets about enjoying life. Here's the first one. Be thankful. If you want to have a good life, be thankful for today's blessings and provision.
Yes.
Solomon wrote this. Now, that's basically what it's saying. Now go, eat your food with gladness, and drink your wine with a joyful heart, for God has already approved what you do. So what Solomon is saying here is that if you have been favored by God, if God has forgiven you, and He is with you, then the blessings that you have of everyday life, if you turn those blessings into thankfulness and sacrifice of praise, then guess what? You experience a certain kind of contentment and peace that the world doesn't understand. You see, gratitude brings contentment. Why is it that we think, oh, I'm not really going to be grateful until I have this, you know, whatever this might be? Or I can't really be thankful until I get here, or have this job, or or live here. We can exercise gratitude and find enjoyment in life by being thankful for what we have right now, in the moment. Hebrews chapter 13 says, having food and clothing therewith to be content, because he has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So contentment, enjoyment in life can be experienced if we're grateful for the everyday, what we would say, little things. But I tell you what, if you were plucked up and dropped in some other country, the little things that we say are little wouldn't be so little there. Amen. If we have food this morning that we could eat, if we woke up in a bed, if we rode in a car, wow, those are big things for a lot of people.
Amen.
Okay, so gratitude, contentment. Gratitude also brings optimism. Here's what the Bible says. Solomon said this, always be clothed in white and anoint your head with oil. Now, what does he mean by that? Are we to just, you know, always be dressed in white, as far as white suit and all that? Now, back in that day, if people were expressing great cheerfulness or festivity, then they would wear white. And they would have certain types of lotion, like olive oil or whatever, and they would wash their face and put the oil on their face, and what would they do? That would make them shine, right? They would be radiant, right? It's nice, I have a little echo here, you know? So, what Solomon is saying, if you want to enjoy life, then don't choose to be a pessimistic, negative person always just looking for what's wrong in life. Now, I think of one person who has so much, but he complains like crazy. He can't enjoy life because he's always looking at what he doesn't have or what's wrong with the country. So, be clothed in white, always anoint your head with oil, means that we can still be cheerful. Is that okay to be cheerful?
Amen.
Does everything go right in life?
No.
Yeah, you're going to have flat tires. You're going to have things go wrong. I'm going to have things go wrong. We can let that depress us, or we can say, you know what, Lord? I'm still going to enjoy you.
Amen.
I'm going to enjoy life.
Amen.
Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
I choose hope rather than despair.
Yes.
I choose to have faith that God's going to provide no matter what happens.
Yes.
All right. You can enjoy life. If you're going to enjoy life, then you have to learn to do this. And it's not always easy. Okay? Just give you a heads up. Love the people around you. Now, I'm going to show you a verse here. Don't be, like, sad if you say, well, I'm not married, I don't have a wife. It's okay. Hold on with me. Enjoy life. That's what he says. With the wife. With your wife, whom you love, all the days of this meaningless life that God has given you under the sun, all your meaningless days. For this is your lot in life and in your toilsome labor under the sun. Now, on the one hand, he seems to be saying, you know, yes, enjoy life. And then on the other hand, he seems to be saying, it's all meaningless. Well, understand that the word meaningless also means passing quickly. You know, the word means breath. Okay, do this with me. Breathe in, and then go. From God's perspective, that's our whole life. And so, life is like a breath. James even says it's like a vapor that appears for a little time and goes away. And so that's what Solomon is saying, that he looks around and he even considers his own life. He says it's just a breath that goes so fast. That's what he means by saying meaningless. Passing quickly. Going. Alright? The elephant in the room. We're die. But he said, in spite of that, don't just focus on the elephants, but love the people around you. Enjoy life with your wife, for example. Now, that's a good thing to do. If you're married, you're a husband, you have a wife, it's a good thing to enjoy your wife. I was in a counseling session many years ago with a couple, and every time the wife would try to say something, you know, he'd shut her up, and he'd call her stupid, and call her names, and finally, I just stopped, and I said, would you take this pen that I give to you, and I said, would you please stab yourself with it? He said, what? I said, yeah, go ahead, stab yourself. He said, no, I wouldn't do that. I said, well, why? He said, you know, God, that'd be stupid, that'd be a lot of pain. I said, well, you know, the Bible says that you and your wife are one flesh. So what you do to her to cause pain, you actually inflict upon yourself. So when you cut her down and call her stupid and she gets depressed, well, guess what? You have a very depressed marriage. And you experience a lot of pain because of what you're doing. So it's a good thing to love. Because when we love, then we build the other person up, and that also helps us. Now, but you say, well, I'm not married. Well, okay. Then love the people around you. Jesus wasn't married either. Do you think he moped around, you know? Just, guys, just do the best you can, but, you know. There was an occasion where Jesus was teaching, and he had a good crowd of people around him. And some of the ushers came and interrupted the meeting and said, Jesus, your mother and your brothers are outside, and they want to talk to you. As if, well, these are VIP people, you know. Now, Jesus didn't, he didn't down his mother and his brothers. He didn't, disrespect them. But he looked around and he said, well, who's my mother? Who are my brothers? Who are my sisters? Isn't it those that hear the word of God and do it? So Jesus loved the people where he was. And so I would say to you that even if you're not married or even if you are, love the people around you. And it starts with us. Now I'll give you the challenge, I'll let you know that it's not always easy.
Amen.
Sometimes I think the world is flat. Okay? I'll just go on record and say that. You know why? Because sometimes I invest in people and I love in people and they fall off the end of the earth. They just fall off. So, where'd they go? I have no idea. The earth must be flat because they're falling and they can't get up back. Just because that happens, don't stop loving people. Right?
No.
Because loving isn't just for other people, it's for you to be like Jesus.
Amen.
So, if you're going to enjoy life, look around and see, God, who am I going to love? How am I going to be a blessing? You'll enjoy life. You want to be miserable? Just think about how people don't love you as much as they should. Enjoy your misery. All right. Now, this is good. You gotta have this, okay? Enjoy a good life. Use the strength that you have. Here's what the Bible says. Now, talk about Labor Day. This is an amazing verse for Labor Day attitude. Okay? Well, we all need an attitude adjustment once in a while. Some more than others. But the Bible says this. I want you to read it with me, okay? You've got to say these words. Ready? Whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all your might. Okay, would the other group, would you also join in and read it? It's two groups. Always happens. I have to do it two times. Ready? Whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all your might. Awesome. There you go. That's the attitude of finding enjoyment. Now, you're not working, you want to work. Right? So the best thing we can do in life is that as we're working, to do that with our heart. If you're an employer, the best joy that you have in your life is a person that's working for you that loves to do what they're doing. That does even more than what you ask. That when you leave the room, they don't lay down on the carpet and take a nap. Right? Because they're okay. They're good workers. Those are people that bring joy to employers. And so the scripture tells us that whatever strength that God has given to us, we're to use that strength in good work. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we'll get paid for it. Sometimes not. But enjoying the journey of work.
Amen.
Sadly, we have this tendency to look in life at just the things that we can't do. Now, we had a work night here on Thursday night. I don't like to stop Bible study, but occasionally it's good for us to put the Bible into practice and to do things, you know, serve. And that's one of the ways that we serve. This past Thursday night, we had at least 20 people here. They were like little bees all over the place. It was awesome. We had so much done. But you know, we did not get together at the beginning and just focus on what we could not do. I didn't say to the group, "So, folks, there's some shingles that are loose on the steeple. That's our project tonight." What would we have accomplished? I'm not going up there either. Believe me. If you see someone up there that looks like me, it's not me. So we don't look at what we can't do, we look at what we can do. So we had people working with carpentry, we had people working with Windex, we had people, you know, sweeping, we had all kinds of projects that we did that helps make our testimony better to our community. And so they were working at it with their heart. Do what you can. Finish well. I think about that. You know, when you pass over some thresholds, like the 20s, and the 30s, and the 40s, and the 50s, you sort of like become more aware that you're not going to be on the earth forever. And if Jesus doesn't come back and pick us up, then, you know, I'm going to go pass through that river of death just like you will. But you know, that doesn't have to be depressing. Why should I sit in my living room and just look at that elephant of death?
Whoa, you're going to die one day. That is really depressing. I wonder how it's going to be. I wonder how it's going to feel. I know it won't be good.
What a waste. What a waste of time and energy. Well, this guy thought about this. Solomon did. He described it somewhat as far as his own view under the sun. For in the realm of the dead, where you are going, there is neither working nor planning nor knowledge nor wisdom. So, what are we to do? Aging, you guys are getting older, by the way. I think if you're in your 20s or teens, that, you know what, I don't even think about it, you will think about it. Aging doesn't have to be a downer. It can be a real incentive.
Amen.
Amen.
Athletes then, that are still playing the game, they're getting older, you know what they do? They say, well, I can't run as fast as this 21-year-old. But I learned a lot about the game. And so what they do, instead of trying to work harder, they work smarter. And they know even if they can't beat the other person in a race, they can be at the right place at the right time before they are, because they know the game. And so the aging process as we get older doesn't have to discourage us like the world is discouraged. There's a beautiful actress who was saying, you know, my greatest enemy in this world is time. Why? Because every day her beauty is diminishing a little bit less. And she's deathly afraid of that. But we don't find our identity in our outward appearance. Our identity is in Christ. Amen. And so aging doesn't have to depress us, neither does death have to depress us. Why? Because we serve one who already died for us. And so death does not separate us from God. Death simply ushers us into the presence of God.
Amen.
Do you believe that?
Yes.
I am not afraid of death. The Bible says, amen, the Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord.
Amen.
That's pretty good news for me. Yeah, I kind of look both ways when I go across the street, I do that. But if someone is crazy and goes out of their way and runs me over and I'm dead, then it's a better place for me.
Amen.
I love this place, but that's a better place. So death has lost its sting because of what Jesus Christ has done.
Amen.
But I'll give you a warning here. There's no do-over. That's what he's saying, Solomon's saying. You don't come back and get another chance to make it all right. If we're going to go after a good life, then we better do it now.
Amen.
Okay? Because this is what we have. Here's what Jesus said. As long as it is day, we must do the works of him who sent me. Night is coming when no man can work. So what's the night? You know, it's like if your life is like a day, then you're born in the morning, you live your young years, you're in your afternoon years, you're in your sunset years. Nighttime comes when your work is over. My work is over. And so the time to work, the time to enjoy life is now.
Amen.
The night's coming. Do what really matters. There was a young man who had heard a lot about Las Vegas. And so he decided that he's going to go ahead on his trip to Las Vegas all by himself. He's going to have the party of his life. So he goes, he lives it up, he goes back into his hotel room, and he kills himself. Suicide in his hotel. He leaves one statement that he has scrawled out. And here's what it said. Here, there are no answers. That's what he wrote before he killed himself. Here, there are no answers. So I can tell you that assuredly from the Word of God, that you will not find your answers to a good life in this world. You won't find them because they're not there. C.S. Lewis said this. He said, God can't give us peace and happiness apart from himself because there is no such thing. Mm-hmm. I like that. Mm-hmm. And so Solomon, this man of wisdom, who's searching for the good life, ends the book that he writes, Book of Ecclesiastes, with this statement. Now, all has been heard. Here is the conclusion of the matter. Fear God and keep his commandments. For this is the duty of all mankind. Wow. Do you want to have a good life? Do you? Is there anybody here that feels, that wants to say to me, Pastor, I really, I just want my life to stand. I really do. I hate my life, and I just hope it will be the worst life ever. Anybody? No, that's, people like that are in rooms somewhere, needing help. But we want to have a good life, don't we?
Yeah.
Let me end by saying this. Don't run after happiness. Your definition of it. Fear God. Love God. Keep His word. Follow Jesus. And happiness will run after you.
Amen.
Amen.
That's it. That's the truth.
Yes.
Of the word of God.